left here, 76 left. Freiburg goes for the kill. He's going to pick it up. If Justin Sisson survives, he's going to win the round. There's no time. Oh, my God, Freiburg, are you kidding me? Because of it.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of By the Numbers. I am Richard Lewis, your host for the show, and my co-host, despite the fact he does absolutely no hosting whatsoever, is Duncan Thorin Shields. We're both back from DreamHack. I've already been moaning about how bad my day's been, Duncan. What about yourself?
Yeah, not too bad. Like you say, I do get equal billing as a host, despite the fact that I just answer questions you set up. But aside from that, yeah, please do some more work. For the same money.
I'm going to do that. I'm going to need it. Every sweet, sweet penny of it. But yeah, so look, let's start there. Let's start with DreamHack. Obviously, DreamHack summer just happened. We were both there. It should be relatively fresh in the memory, more so for you because you didn't attend the after party, although by the time we got there, the party had sort of already ended. It had already plateaued out. There was no booze left. It was really upsetting.
Sounds like a great party.
Yeah, it was pretty good. But anyway, I definitely won't moan about that. Not on Twitch. That would be horrible. So obviously another Fnatic win. I guess we start there. Let's start with the winners and work our way backwards. So I still don't think Fnatic looked all that polished. And of course, TSM wasn't there. Who are their kryptonite after all. But ultimately, their level of individual performance just means that even when they're not having a particularly great day tactically, when that synergy isn't there, they're always going to be able to do enough to beat almost anyone else in the scene. So my question for you is, well, first of all, just how good are this Fnatic team? And second of all, are we realistically looking at only TSM being capable of beating them in the current pro scene?
I mean, I'd concur with what you said. They definitely didn't look at their best. I mean, yeah, okay, at times they might have like a map where they looked really good. Like the first map against Na'Vi, yeah, they just blitzed them. But against everyone, okay, they had times where people could come close to them. And that's the thing, though. We're talking about like this wasn't them at their best. And then you realize, wait a minute, they didn't lose a map in the tournament. They clearly, in the end, were better than every team they faced. That just shows how good as a team and how high their top level is, you know. I mean, for example, they just won the whole event without losing a map. And yet, actually, when I think back on it, JW was actually suspiciously quiet that whole event. He had almost none of those crazy highlights that usually you can put your money down that he's going to have them. I think I even saw him make a tweet saying, like, you know, his form's, he needs to rediscover his form. Like, think about what a world this is. I know great players. Think of, like, Device until recently, who've never been in a final. This guy's won like 10 tournaments. And so he can talk about a tournament he just won undefeated. Is like, yeah, of course, that was one of my bad tournaments. Like, I'm hoping I can pick things up again, you know, get where I need to be. Like, that's the sort of dream world Fnatic's living in. Now, like you say, though, there is one team out there at the moment who you'd actually put your money on to beat them at the moment, TSM. So if they go to the same LAN, hey, that's one of the great things, I think, about the open circuit is that if this was just one really long league, there wouldn't actually be as much excitement for the next time those two meet and if it's going to be in a final. Whereas the storyline of, okay, Fnatic, TSM's beaten them a few times, then Fnatic keeps winning every tournament TSM is in, obviously setting up the obvious question, okay, but then if they meet TSM again, have they figured something out or will it be the same old story? I mean, I think it makes the next meeting, it only gets better every time for me.
Yeah, I agree. It's an interesting, I suppose it's a lot better than, the say, for example, the NIP phase of CSGO, where it was literally during that 87-0 run. I mean, I remember lots of people at that time, they were saying, this is actually going to kill the competitive scene. Like, CSGO is going to be, you know, if NIP keep winning everything, nobody's going to want to watch it anymore.
I think Taz literally said that in an interview. He said something like that if NIP keeps winning, it will kill the game. Which obviously, I mean, even he meant it as hyperbole, you know, but he just meant as in people aren't going to be as excited because coming from the 1.6 era, even if you had a really dominant period, it's very rare it lasted more than about, we always used to say a year, but you really about 9 months is about the most you could really be expected to dominate. And ironically, that actually is about how long NIP's domination lasted. It's just at the time, because they never lost a map, it felt like forever, you know.
Yeah.
Not like 5 years or something.
And that's what I mean. There wasn't really a nemesis in that Nip phase. They didn't have a kryptonite. Everybody would try. And, you know, whichever team made it to the final against them, it was this air of inevitability. It was almost as if second place had to be what you had to aim for and strive for during that era. And to be honest, I remember lots of finals. I think I remember one with the young Danish guys, some of which are at Dignitas now, Pimp. And whatnot. I can't remember what team. I'm presuming it would have been the Copenhagen Wolves or Western Wolves. Sorry, that was it. I knew there was some Wolves in it. But I remember that. I remember watching that final distinctly, and it was almost as if it was just like they were just so happy to have made the final and be playing Nip in a final that, you know, that pressure's off, lads. We've done it, you know. And at least now with TSM, we know that they can be beaten. I still haven't quite figured out why it's only TSM that can consistently beat Fnatic, though.
I mean, it's something I'm thinking about myself. Like, I've been thinking about it ever since they started winning. I mean, the first thing that I would go to immediately is not like skill level and all that stuff, because all that's like a good secondary point. The first thing I'd go to is that TSM's the first team I've ever seen who had the right kind of map pool against Fnatic. Because first and foremost, the way Fnatic always used to have an edge over everyone is that it's that sound counterintuitive, but Fnatic wanted to play the same maps as the other teams. Now, this will sound weird, but because TSM has the exact same scenario, they want to play the same maps as Fnatic does, but they have a couple that they're better on. So they're basically doing to Fnatic what Fnatic used to be able to do to Envious, do to NIP, do to all those teams at the time, where in the past, yeah, Fnatic was loving playing maps like Inferno. Hey, yeah, let's get us to all these different maps that we think we have a chance of Mirage, whatever. But now TSM's going to beat you on most of those maps if you're Fnatic. So now it's Fnatic that has to be the one who has to change it up, find new maps to play on, which they thought they'd done with Cobblestone. Obviously, they only played it once, but they lost that. So for the first time ever, I've seen Fnatic be the ones who are uncomfortable, and they're the ones picking towards the outer edge of the map pool, which never happened before. They used to be the guys who just went to the ones that were obvious for them, and other people were kind of left running.
So I think the terrifying thing as well is that whenever I've watched Fnatic win tournaments lately, which of course has been very frequently, I got to say it's almost as if they never need, like, all we talk about lots of teams, how we like all five have to be at their best, right? Titan, Na'Vi, and obviously we'll get onto that in a moment. But Fnatic actually don't need all five to be at their best, and very rarely are all five at their best. This tournament, as you said, JW was a little bit missing, but the partnership of Olaf Meister, who had a much better tournament this time around than he did on the second day of Fragbite, combined with Krims really stepping up and looking a lot more like his old self, you know, the player that was indeed for a very short period of time considered the best in the world. That's all you need. That partnership locks out an entire bomb site as terrorist. And we saw Olaf Meister make so many clutches. I think the thing that really terrifies me about this Fnatic team overall is numbers mean absolutely nothing. You can be watching like a normal game with normal human teams, and you can be like, okay, it's 2-on-5. The team two should just save. They've got no chance of winning it. With Fnatic, 2-on-5 means nothing because they're all capable of effectively acing a team. And we saw that in the final against Na'Vi. 14-14, Na'Vi have a 4-on-2 in their favor. Yeah, turns out against Fnatic, that's absolutely meaningless. So it is terrifying, really. I don't think we've seen the absolute peak level of this team yet.
Well, that's also why, even if you're TSM, you can't sort of be like, okay, well, we beat Fnatic every time now. You can forget about that. We'll worry about the other teams because, listen, actually, Fnatic has played well in some of the TSM finals, but if Fnatic ever hits the peak where they were at, say, 3 months ago, something around that phase, would TSM beat that Fnatic? I don't know. Now, it may be the case that maybe TSM really is the counter, and so as a result, it's unfair to say that, like, TSM is making Fnatic not able to be played that way. That could definitely be the case. And obviously, we haven't seen enough matchups to know for sure. But I do feel as though, yeah, I actually agree with you. Aside from, let me think. I think DreamHack Tours is the closest they've come maybe to being, like, really high level. And even then, they managed to lose that one map in overtime to Hellraisers. So, because what's funny is I'm thinking of Gfinity, the one where, if you remember the final, okay, they 3-0'd versus Pro, which is unreal. Like, that's ridiculously dominant. But then in the group stage, that was where they were losing maps to...
Yeah.
Vox, you know, so that's what's crazy. They're winning these tournaments without being like in, they're not in this god tier Nip form where no one could ever touch them. It's just somehow they always win the tournament.
I don't know if it's a little bit like maybe they're trying to just sort of stay within themselves. Like, I always felt when you were watching NIP, they literally, like, every game, like, once they started that streak and it became into, ooh, this is potentially record-breaking territory, it's like they gave their all every time they played, because it wasn't necessarily just about the wins, it was about the streak. I don't think Fnatic are quite as interested in that. I think they just want to be a dynastic team in a different sense. They just want to win the tournament, and therefore they know, hey, we don't need to try quite so hard. You know, we can draw a few games. That Gfinity tournament, for example, where the format was a little bit different to what we're used to. So, I mean, I think in a way it's almost as if they marshal their resources like quite deliberately and then turn it on when they need to. But still, it's got to be said, it's going to be interesting to see what happens now, because sure, we're all talking about TSM being their kryptonite, but let's not forget TSM, and now they can't attend tournaments. They got exams. There's a real chance here for Fnatic to hit that peak that we both agree they haven't yet. And when TSM do come back, maybe things will be very different.
Yeah, that's why I'm not entirely sold in it. Like, one of the things I've been thinking about ever since TSM got this little streak of tournaments going is I've been thinking, I've mentioned this a few times already, which is the problem is it's mainly Fnatic that TSM's facing. And yeah, they're rinsing Fnatic. But the problem is we haven't seen actually TSM against some of the other teams that much. So not only am I interested to see them against the other teams in that sense, but put it this way, it sounds weird when you've just described that one team's repeatedly beating Fnatic, but no one else really is. That's the thing. So yeah, if TSM isn't the one who's doing it, will Fnatic just keep winning all the tournaments? At the moment, you look at it and go, well, I guess they probably would, because run down the list, like Envious is slumping, NIP's in a bad shape, yeah. Virtus Pro, so they're hanging around there, but they're the ones who just got rinsed out 3-0 by them. Titan have a trouble even getting to finals to play Fnatic. Okay, Na'Vi play them close each time, but they haven't been able to beat them. So you're running out of other teams aside from TSM who can beat them. So actually, in some senses, TSM's like, they're our only hope. You know, they're Obi-Wan Kenobi. We need them if Fnatic's going to be toppled, this empire.
Yeah.
Or Fnatic could take care of themselves and implode some way, which also, by the way, that's the other outside chance. If TSM beats them enough, maybe Fnatic tilts and someone leaves, or, you know, who knows?
So let's talk about some rumors then. All right, because, you know, that's kind of the thing I do. You know, I've always got my ear to the ground. And I don't treat all rumors equally. But one of the ones doing the rounds, which is being talked about by pros and other people around the scene, is that a Fnatic roster change could be imminent, that the likely person heading out the door would be JW, minimum one change. I don't know why that would be the case. I mean, I can't think of anything within that team dynamic that would make me, if I was one of the players, think, yeah, we're winning everything right now, but, you know, Flush has got bad breath or something. Like, do you know what I mean? Like, just, like, want to quit. It just seems insane that you would throw that away for, like, some, yeah, just be professional, man up. We all work with people we hate. I'm sure you can identify with that, Thorin, just from doing this show. So, well, you know, is there a chance that that's real? And if so, what would it mean?
I actually think there is. I don't know. Here's the thing. Even though as a rumor, it's presented as though, like, oh, you know, this is going to happen. That's where I'm not quite sure. Like, I don't know. Maybe it's an idea that's out there, you know. Maybe someone's been thinking about it. But actually players, in a sense, because they all talk to their friends who are players and stuff gets out there, some of them are just thinking aloud. Like, you know, like maybe they have a week where that guy's annoying them and they said, oh, you know, I might just leave. That doesn't mean it's necessarily going to happen. So I don't think it's like a high chance, but I could believe it. Put it so I wouldn't dismiss it out of hand. And if it is JW, I also, if I had to speculate the reason why, thinking about JW's personality, he is the sort of player where, as bizarre as this sounds, I don't know that he does think it's like awesome to just be like the third best player, win all the tournaments, but have everyone go, oh, JW, man, Fnatic's so good. That Olaf Meister is just the best player in the world, isn't he? And he's like, yeah, he's a great teammate. Huh? I love playing with players better than me. Like, I think there's a little bit of JW sort of like, I'm the star. Olaf Meister, I'm the captain now. Like, that sort of shit, you know. So part of me does think maybe he thinks to himself, if he went somewhere else, he could be the superstar. You know, maybe at the moment he has a role, but hey, make the team around me, make it like when Kenny S was in Titan, I'll show you what I'm made of, you know. Now, the problem with that, obviously, is that in itself is such a ridiculous reason to leave. But beyond that, even within that is the reason why it's even more ridiculous. So not only you win every tournament, but remember the first part there, you're going to leave playing on the team with the best player in the world and go somewhere else. Now, I think I could see some ways that could backfire on you in terms of you won't have the best player on your team anymore. The other side of that, you might have to play against the best player, lose and go, yeah, that side of it isn't as fun as I thought, actually. It's actually better to not be that good but be on his team, you know.
Yeah.
I would never do it if it was me, put it that way.
Well, I mean, you know, the other question, of course, is where he would actually go. Now, again, there's been rumors that this is going to be a Swedish-based shuffle. NIP would be the beneficiaries of JW services. That's one scenario people are talking about. I don't put any credence in that, actually, but who knows? Maybe that is how it's going to go. Would that make the difference? I'm using this as a transition to get to talk about NIP and leave our Fnatic love in behind. But just while we're on that subject, I mean, is that something that could make the difference? If you add JW to an NIP, do we get a realistic challenger for Fnatic?
You do, but partly because you've taken JW off Fnatic. So that will help add some parity to it. The problem is, I can't see from the JW side of thing why you do that move, because the NIP team you're going to join isn't going to be as good as your previous Fnatic. It might be able to win even, but again, I mean, pretty so let's use this logic. If part of the reason why you might make the move is because you're losing to TSM anyway, well, what makes you think you're going to beat TSM or NIP? Mm. You know, that part doesn't add up entirely. But whatever, players don't think that way. Sometimes if they have personal issues, they get crazy. You know, they just want out there somehow. So maybe it's possible. I have to say, I will put this out there, okay? For all the NIP fans out there who live in this dream world where they listen to interviews and they think everything said in interviews is gospel and every player loves each other, NIP, here's a little bombshell for you guys. Your NIP, your beloved NIP, with those four players who were like brothers who'd never split up, they would have definitely kicked people out of that foursome and had some of the players we're maybe referencing now in their team, but those players turned them down. So, it's Father Christmas, not real, guys. Nah. Anyway, back to reality. They love each other, so of course not, Richard. Why would they ever break up?
I think another thing, like, if we're bursting bubbles as well, was that actually there was lots of talk from the management as well. Back in the, back when they sort of first hit that slump and the streak ended, there was a lot of pressure to get people out, and this probably isn't in the public domain either, but there was some very awkward Skype calls where people were like, look, we got to change this up, we need to get rid of Fiflara and get rid of Freiburg, but whoever had a bad tournament week was being targeted, and that's internally. So that was why, as you rightly point out, and if I remember rightly, was Twist one of the players?
I think he was a name that was mentioned in there. You know, it's a small handful, but it was a few that people could probably guess. The thing is, I will just say, even though I did that obviously to add a little bit of salt to the wound.
Of course.
I will just say, by the way, the whole point I'm making there is not that NIP's some nefarious organization. It's that they're just another organization, guys. Like every team in history of Counter-Strike, when your results are going badly, people start to think, could we upgrade that guy there? Or which one of us, which one is not like the others? All that stuff goes on. But maybe you guys, because of the great history, naively thought, no, NIP's different from that. It's a special team and all that. Unfortunately, it's not. The things they accomplished are special, but they're just a bunch of guys. So that's inevitable. It's actually amazing they've lasted this long without any moves happening. I'm amazed. What's it like 3 years now they've been hanging around with only one actual of the original five gone. So it's got to happen sooner or later, I'm afraid, unless some miracle happens, basically.
Well, what did you make of NIP's performance at DreamHack? I got to say, again, they seem to be struggling with this whole... They have one or two players turn up, but never enough of the players to make a difference at once. So I thought, for example, this tournament, Forrest had some great games. He had some really poor games as well, like the Na'Vi Cobble game, I think it was, where he was bottom fragging, missed some really easy shots, not up to his usual standard. But in particular, I thought Freiburg, that's the best I've seen him play offline in a long time. I thought he was really consistent, did really well. And he's been one of the weak links, actually, for a while. So it was good to see him turn it around.
Problem is, though, he had his problems against Fnatic. So
Yeah.
That's the other thing. Even when what's weird now is we've now entered a weird phase where before some of the players played really badly, but you were like, oh, well, at least Alu would get right, I'll carry us. Now I think it's an even more disturbing period when it's like they just cycle game to game who does well, which actually is more frustrating if I'm a NIP guy, because now you at least kind of want one part to be stable so you can then go, right, we've got that in place. Now, what do we need to work with that guy to make the rest of the team better? At the moment, it's just a bunch of moving parts, and you just hope that the right two or three people have a good game and we have a chance here, because otherwise you can have games like in this tournament against Fnatic where you're not necessarily got much chance to win.
Yeah. So with that in mind, do you think, was there anything there to make you think that NIP are going to get back to be, you know, to challenging the likes of Fnatic, or do you think realistically now we are going to have to wait and see if they do commit to the idea of a roster change, because they've changed captains, they've changed positions, they've changed tactics, they've been working on new strategies. They've pretty much tried every option at this point, and nothing's quite working to get them back to that number one spot. I don't think in the current climate there's any shame in being second, third, fourth. You know, being in that top four of elite CSGO teams is still an amazing achievement.
Sure.
But do you think it's going to take a roster change or somebody retiring to really put NIP back to what they were?
Yeah, I think so, especially because, like you say, it's almost like they've tried every permutation of different roles, setups, different person calling, bringing a coach, changing up even maps tournament to tournament, what you're doing well on. The problem is this, on the upside, there are teams that are still very good teams that they can beat and they can do well. Like, what's interesting is I'd actually like to see NIP play against TSM, because when TSM won that Face It tournament, if you remember, the first map, they totally were crap and NIP 16 won them. Then the other two maps were actually reasonably close. And that was when TSM had already hit this god mode where they're wrecking Fnatic, you know. So maybe NIP actually has a decent matchup against TSM. I'd like to see that. The problem is, on the bad end of things, you have a NIP that lost to Na'Vi here, went out in the group stage at Gfinity, lost... what else was there? I think there was another... Wasn't there another group stage you went out of? Okay, I can't remember anyway. But you can see the problem is, it's if they have to face people like Fnatic that's going to be hard for them, basically.
Mm.
And as a result, I can't see them being number one, because too many things would have to go right.
Mm. So we'll look at some of the other teams in that second tier. Now, obviously, Na'Vi made it to the final. That was pretty much a given, I felt, at the point where NIP had kind of flopped in the group stage and lost to Na'Vi 16-13 on Cobblestone. So it meant that obviously the final that everyone thought, you know, Fnatic versus NIP couldn't happen. Na'Vi only had to beat Titan. Now, when it got to the final, first map was really comprehensive for Fnatic. But as I did say at the top of the show when talking about Fnatic's strengths, Na'Vi were 14-14 on train and Fnatic win a 2-on-4. And it was a real unfortunate 2-on-4. It was literally Fnatic were just positioned in such a way that they were just going to be beneficiaries of, you know, the ability to be able to pick up some quick kills and turn around on its head. Now, I think Na'Vi are the one team for me that is showing steady improvement, that they're the team from that sort of second tier that could break into the top tier. What do you think?
The problem with that one is that Train was also the map where it went very close to overtime against NIP as well for Fnatic. And Train wasn't a map offline that Fnatic had been playing. It's a new map they've brought in, and they specifically tried to pick it against NIP as like a kind of a wild card, knowing that NIP doesn't like it. So it's not like it'd be one thing if Na'Vi had done that on a map like a Mirage or something that's like a strong Fnatic map. That would be something else, whereas it's kind of a newer map, so I can't put too much in that. With that said, I actually do think with the current climate of things, like with NIP being in a slump, with Envious, no one knows where they're going to be in a few months.
Yeah.
VP at the moment, it's not that they're going up or down. It feels like VP's just a bit stale. Like they feel like they're just stuck in the same position. Like they're going to be like third or fourth, but they won't go higher. They won't go lower. So I feel like actually Na'Vi is the team who can move up. Like I could see Na'Vi in this next, say, 3 months being like the fifth or the fourth best team. I think that's possible. The problem there is to go any higher than that, I don't really see, but I think they can move up a bit more still.
Individuals that stood out for you? I mean, I thought Guardian was actually a little bit quieter this tournament than perhaps we're used to seeing. He had some good
It was mainly in the
in
final.
Flashes.
That's the problem. Because obviously you remember the final the most vividly. It's the last end of the tournament. The thing was, in the rest of the tournament, he was actually blitzing it. He was more consistently good than I think I've seen in a while. But the problem
is... That game on Mirage in particular was ridiculous.
But that's the problem. In the final... Exactly where you need him to go crazy and do that, all that sort of stuff. He was a little bit subdued. He wasn't bad. He still hit good shots. He just didn't do the sort of like take over a whole round by yourself type kills where that's when you can beat any team in theory if you have someone who can win entire rounds by himself. So still an issue there, I think, to some degree. But overall, yeah, I don't think you can really dispute that he was the best player of all. Aside from him, I think Flamey was probably also pretty good at this tournament. I think his level was quite high, a little bit more consistent than I've seen in the past.
I still think that for me the big question marks are around Edward and Seized. Like I'm a big champion of Seized. I think he can be the difference maker. I think, you know, Flamey's almost like a known quantity compared to those two, and of course Edward's great pistol player, someone you can rely on the pistol rounds, which of course is still hugely important in the global offensive meta. But, you know, somebody that I think it would, if he could just play like an extra 10%, Edward, like, you know, I think then this is it. Then they're there. They're in that top elite level. But those two seem to be the ones that have question marks around them. With Seized, it's just a consistency problem. He just doesn't seem to be able to be that guy that can lock down a bomb site. Like, I've used the phrase poor man's Crims to describe him. And when he's on point, that's exactly what he is. He can use terrain, hold a bomb site very cleverly, you know, get two or three kills. But then he'll just have that other round where he's just in a horrific position and just gets caught out.
Contrast the two players, Nip. You just brought them up there, Rich. So we got Crims and we've got Seized. Skill-wise, it's very similar. In fact, actually, in terms of raw aim, it's possible Seize might even have better aim than Crims. But one of the things that about Crims, I don't usually compare out-of-game personality to in-game personality, but in the case of Crims, it's not even that he's ice cold, man, like so cool under pressure. He's someone where I almost think his strength is it seems like he has no personality. Like there's never never any kind of concern of like, oh, how am I doing now in this game? Like, oh, I didn't get as many kills. It feels like he just plays the game. He's almost like a robot, you know. With Seized, okay, the games might have some similarities, but he's like, I think he's overly passionate as a player. And he's the sort of person where, man alive, I've seen him rage at teammates or get angry at himself when he died in a situation. And it's very hard to be a consistent player when you're that sort of personality, I've noticed. Those kinds of guys, you tend to have to go the other way and try and just be so super skilled that when you do explode in game, you win the whole round, you know, or you know that you might blow up and you might throw the game away, but okay, that it's going to even out in that sense. It's hard to be the cool under pressure round by round, grind them down guy. If personality wise, you're not really like that, you know?
So we've talked a little bit about Na'Vi. Let's talk about your favorite team, Titan. This was an opportunity for them to make a final without really playing anyone too challenging. You know, they were in a group with, you know, Flipside. So, you know, they were in a place where all they really had to do was beat Na'Vi in a best of three. And they were in a final. And I personally think they needed to make this final. Now, hugely frustrating if you're a Titan fan. And I'll go into the many reasons why that's true. So first of all, Cobblestone, a map that's very good for Na'Vi. Na'Vi obviously beat Nip on it. Titan, bit of an unknown quantity on it. And Existence just obviously disseminates some brilliant tactics. They go in, they hammer it, 12-3 at halftime, and that's it. That's all she wrote. It's in the books. Then you go into Overpass, which, again, great map for Na'Vi usually. And Na'Vi go 8-0 down. Now, at that point, there should be no coming back for Na'Vi. Titan should have done the unthinkable and made it to the final. I don't know what it was, whether it was Na'Vi being really good or, as I suspect, Titan kind of imploding. And then they lose that Overpass 16-11 after being 8-0 up. And then they go on to Inferno, get 7 T rounds, right? So that's it. You've definitely done it now. Like, if Overpass was an anomaly, 70 rounds on Inferno, you got to do it.
Or at the very least, you've got to lose like 16, 13, 16 points. You can't lose 7 and 16 for that way.
Yeah. And then they lose 16-7. They don't pick up a single CT round to lose the game. So your thoughts about this? Because that, for me, that's almost like an old school Dignitas level choke. That's ridiculous.
Yeah, I mean, the problem here, the first and foremost problem that you have to point out is that despite the miracles they did pull early on Overpass, the fact Overpass was even in the rotation meant that you had to, on paper, be like, well, they've lost that. They immediately have to win this cobble or it's over already, which is, you should never be able to say that about an elite level team, you know, which Titan aren't at the moment, as we saw in this series. So one of their problems I can see for them immediately is that Overpass and Train are maps that at the moment they have no proficiency on whatsoever. They don't even want to play them. So anyone who's willing to pick an Overpass or a Train against them, well, they can only ban one. So you're going to get one of those against them. Now, it's true, Titan can look good because a lot of teams won't play those maps at the moment. Like, luckily for them, a lot of the elite teams don't particularly like Overpass. And at the moment, no teams in general tend to actually pick into Train. So it's unfortunate that they had Na'Vi in that sense, because Na'Vi was going to exploit that weakness. With that said, I've kind of just grown used to this happening to Titan. I always feel like in a best of three, I always know Titan's going to get at least a map against almost anyone. And they'll have another map where either it's like a 50-50 or they show like one good half, and there's always that second half breakdown. And so I actually think this, though, was the most frustrating, not just because it was Na'Vi, but because actually in the past months, I could always say, okay, well, you know, Kenny S isn't at his old level. But actually, this tournament, Kenny S was almost at his old level. Like you even look at the numbers, and the numbers are the same as when Kenny S was in God mode, you know. So if that can happen and the same outcome happens, I don't know what there is to hope for Titan. I don't really have any hope for them. I just like I like to watch them because I enjoy their style, okay? But as a result, it's like watching a great heist movie where they get caught at the end. No matter how many times you watch it, you know they get caught at the end. You know, that's going to be a sad ending, but you have to enjoy the part up until they get caught rich.
Yeah. Or Carlito's Way, perhaps. Benny, they keep getting Benny Blanco'd when it comes to the semis. But look, here's the thing. Like, so I'll follow on from your point about Kenny S. We all saw the interview. Oh, I'm struggling for confidence. I'm not like my old self. We all know the potential this guy's got. We all know he can be an absolute god. But that hasn't been the case for about, you know, it's getting more now. It's like, you know, 8 months, 9 months. It's been a while since we really saw him be a player that was not only the best AWPer in the world, but a player who could just go to four other players, jump on, kids, I got this. Like that thing in the Never-Ending Story, you know what I mean? Just jump on my back, I'll fly us to wherever we want to go.
He looked like Rich.
That was it, mate. Come on. I mean, that's a lot longer for me to remember, right? So, so Kenny S looks more like his old self this tournament. There's no doubt about it. That was a performance. Even against Na'Vi, even as they're losing, even as they're hemorrhaging rounds, he was still the guy that was like, look, I'm getting entry kills. I'm getting, you know, two or three kills around. Why are we losing, guys? And it's like you said, Elo hell for Kenny S. Now, does this bode well? Like, can Titan at least build around the fact that Kenny S might be back? Or is it too soon to say that Kenny S is actually back?
The problem is, to me, you have no choice. Like, when I look at the lineup of the players in the team, okay, supposedly in the last few months, they tried like changing some of Kenny's setups when he was having poor games, giving other people more favorable focus in the team. The problem with that was it was purely a band-aid move. Like, it actually did get them, they stayed at the same level, but they never were able to go beyond that level. So to me, it's kind of like you have to go all in on Kenny, and either he returns to form, great, and we can try and be good again, or he doesn't, in which case, well, you're not anywhere different as it is anyway. Like, I think unfortunately for Titan, they're sort of in the nip scenario where they're just hoping that the better team from their country implodes, or one person gets sick of it and leaves. In which case, hey, now we're cooking with gas. Now maybe we can do something, you know, no matter who it is. But I can't see what Titan can do. It's the same scenario as with NiP. Like, what are the options? I don't know of any. I've thought about it a lot. They've tried a lot of different things. It doesn't seem like anything changes. You just get the same problem slightly differently manifested.
So let's think about that. In fact, actually, just before we do think about that, let's just talk a little bit about their CT sides. Now, you only have to look at the statistics just from that semi-final alone to realize that they're where their problem is. You know, Cobblestone, absolute demolish Na'Vi as a terrorist. I think it was. They got 12 rounds. They start a terrorist, no problem. Only managed to get 4 rounds of CT, but okay, you're over the finish line. No big deal. You have a great first half like that. I guess your CT doesn't really matter. Overpass the 8-0 up as CT. And then they only get one more round. They have this run where I think they got one right near the end. And then they just, you know, they've given away too much and Na'Vi have the lockdown. And then on Inferno, not a single CT round for Titan, which is just mind-blowing. Why are the CT side so bad? It doesn't make any sense to me.
I mean, sadly, it might sound condescending to boil it down to such a simple principle, but in general, especially in CSGO, it's always felt like CT side is largely dependent on just the average skill level in the team, basically. How good each player individually is. And then if you're very good in that respect alone, that's why, to me, the old Dignitas, the ones that now TSM, when they didn't have very good tactics, they could still hang with almost every team in the world because they could just blitz you on CT side because they had all these crazy aimers. They had a really high skill level, actually. Now then, in Titan's case, to me, what makes their T side so good is literally just like a great concept on what to do tactically, knowing how to get everything out of every flash, every smoke, where to put players. So basically they're getting absolutely everything out of their personnel. But then when you switch over to the CT side, because it's not like on T side, they were just blitzing you with raw skill and it's not like they send Olaf M into a site and he just kills 4 people. Yeah. As a result, when you switch to CT side, they're not as good as the teams they face. They're not as good as a Na'Vi, TSM, NIP, Virtus Pro. These teams are all more skilled to me. So add into that. Another thing I've been thinking about recently is it's not like they just get wrecked when they're on CT side. It's not like the enemy runs in and they never even get into a bomb plant situation. They get into lots of after plant situations. They're just not very good at winning in clutch rounds. And when you actually think of their team, they don't have many famous clutch round players on their team. Like, you think of it, okay, what's funny is the two that I think of in their team as clutch round players is actually Existence, just because sometimes he'll have like one of those rounds where he has like a 1v1 and he actually like outthinks the other guy. And then the other one's RPK, just because he's like a really consistent player. Well, if those are your guys who are going to close those rounds out for you, you're probably not going to win many games when they're against, you know, Guardian, this level of player, you know, because you think of the other guys in that team, Apex is never going to be alive at that point in the round if he's done his job even. Maniac's just Maniac. He's not going to super outskill a bunch of people in a 1v2. It's just not reasonable. And then Kenny S, unfortunately, is the guy who's been slumping all this period in time. So you can kind of see where their problem is, that they'd have to be like a Dignitas where they completely blitz you at the beginning of the round and never get into that situation. So again, I think, unfortunately for them, it's probably a personnel issue. And again, that's the one area you can't improve if you're a Titan at the moment.
Which brings me to the final question about surrounding Titan. We've jokingly called it me, you, Anders Semler, when we've been talking about it, you know, the need for a French revolution. We see Envious struggling. We see Titan struggling. We see teams like LDLC White kind of on the precipice of breaking into that, you know, not top 10 by any means, but certainly, you know, top 20. Will they progress? Will they get to other tournaments? It's possible. And yet here we are. And one of the terrifying things that used to be true in Source was that the French scene was just, it was a lot like the Danish scene, just ridiculous talent everywhere. And you could take any 5 French players, or I should include some Swiss and of course Belgian players in with that as well, build a team and they would be capable of beating pretty much anyone. And indeed, very games always seemed, when we needed to make changes, they'd discover a star, you know, like an NBK when he first joined the team, things like that. And they just kept on going. They kept dominance for a ridiculous amount of time, 2.5 to 3 years. Now, all of that said, we don't seem to be in a similar situation in CSGO. And in actual fact, I think there's a team out there that could be on a level of a Fnatic, on the level of a TSM. But you would need to take the very best bits of Titan, the very best bits of Envious. You couldn't have 2 French teams dominating at the top level. Is there any chance of that happening? And do you think if we want to see a top French team, a truly top French team, that's what needs to happen?
The biggest problem is the side that's not willing is the envious side. And the story, unfortunately, goes beyond players. If this was just player versus player, look at the results. You know, inevitably, when this team has a bad run of form, someone will leave, like normal CS. That'd be fine. But the storyline that I'm sure it must have trickled out to people by now, just from interviews and stuff, is that basically everyone who's an envious player doesn't want to play with Existence. And some of the people who are playing with Existence now, Apex, etc., some of them are thought to have backstabbed or screwed over some of the players who were with them before at LDLC. So there's all this personal issues which are making people, I think, a bit blinded to even the possibility of, should I leave this team? Should we bring this guy into our team? So unfortunately, I don't think they're going to consider it unless it really is like the nuclear option. It's the last thing you can do. So that's unfortunate. I do feel as though at the moment, the two teams are like mirror opposites of each other. Like I look at Titan and as I described them there, they don't have that much skill to me. It was mainly all focused in Kenny S and then a bit in Apex, but they got everything out of their skill. And they had these amazing terrorist tactics and then CT side, they did what they could. Meanwhile, I look over at Envious and they have this abundance of talent, too much skill almost. And then they use this really free-for-all style, incredibly loose. They do whatever they want. They're just up and down, but they can blitz anyone on any side of the game. It's like you're such polar opposites that to me, the obvious solution would actually be to build two good teams from both sets rosters, but have it be more reasonable on both ends, you know, be more like a real CS team, like a bit of tactics, bit of skill, like let's mix it up together. Instead, they've gone these two extremes, you know, and partly, as I mentioned, because it's almost like an ideological thing driving them away from each other.
Yeah. I got to say as well, you know, Apex didn't have a great tournament overall. Again, I think he was poor. We've talked about the importance of Titan and how they need all their components to come together. There's a specter over the team in the form of Maniac. He doesn't want to go all in, doesn't want to commit to a full-time life within Titan because he's got a full-time job, pays very well. He's very dedicated to that. That's actually meant that they've had to withdraw from some tournaments, I think Star Ladder, because they're not able to attend. And on top of all of these things that are going on, word on the street is, and this is, again, all rumor, I'm not confirming it, but this is what people are talking about at events in the green room, is that the personnel behind Titan, the people who run the organization, are actually getting a little bit sick and tired of this underachievement, that they've put in ridiculous amounts of investment and they haven't seen a return. And now they're really thinking, you know, do we even look elsewhere for a team? Do we bother with CSGO at all? Now, again,
yep.
I imagine that's a wild scenario. I don't see them pulling the plug. But for me, I felt they needed to at least make the final at DreamHack or something's going to give.
Put it this way, here's the problem if you're the Titan organization. It's that if you look at the team and you listen to the team and they're like, listen, things are going wrong. We should have made the final. Here's a crazy statement for you, Rich. Titan aren't underachieving at all. Titan are achieving exactly where their roster and their team should get. In fact, they're actually pretty consistent. They repeatedly get to sort of semis, top fours. Maybe they could make the odd final like they once did. But in general, they're not going to be a top four team. I mean, they've proven it. They've made it quite consistent which maps they're good on, which sides they're good on, which players are going to do well. So as a result, if you're Titan the org, if you can't live with what you've got right now, then it's true. You better do something about it because right now, nothing's going to change. The problem is I do feel for the Titan org because it feels a bit like, I feel a bit like they might feel like they got a false bill of goods. Because remember the history of when they got this team?
Absolutely.
Was they bought into the team of like, hey, we're getting the best team in the world. Because when they got them was when VeryGames was still ranked the number one team in the world. Then the team had all the players still, but they had that early period where they just flunked the major. And then suddenly Shox, the best player in the world, leaves the team. Somehow they recover. They get Kenny S back in. They make that work, which was a miracle in itself. They get a very good team again with like a top four team. Then obviously the French Revolution happens. It's like somehow they end up with the weaker end of that. But even then, they still had a team where it was like Titan now, but kind of like a supercharged version of this Titan, where, okay, they weren't going to be the best, but the difference is their high point on a really good game was higher. They were more like a Na'Vi in terms of explosiveness, you know. So as you saw, they won the DreamHack Stockholm. They could do very well against these. Then Kaylee gets banned. There's like four or five things that Titan, as an org, could never have predicted. All bad that have happened in a row to get them to the point where they had the best team in the world, then a top four team in the world, then a top six team in the world. And now they've got like the seventh or eighth best team in the world. And so I have to say, if I was the Titan org, I might actually go elsewhere. I might just wait for another one of those contracts above me to come available and just say, hey, you want to come and play for me? Because what I heard was Titan, the org, supposedly gave them, this was one of the first really good deals in CSGO when they changed from very good.
Oh, no, no, you don't know how good, though.
So this was org who had money to spend, you know, and they thought, hey, we're getting the best team. So I can understand why they might look at like the seventh best team and go, this is not what I'm paying for, you know.
This is how good it was. The organization that Titan, the team that Titan originally picked up turned down Alliance. So fucking wrap your head around that, the Garfield money train.
Oh, and remember, they were the team who got a team house back before stickers and all that
straight
stuff.
Straight away, though.
They had a team house and everyone was living in it. So they obviously had budget that was way above pretty much every other team. So, they've had a great run of form. They had some great performances, but the titles aren't there if you're Titan. As in the title, listen, here's the problem. The titles in those players' career do exist in CSGO, but the problem is they were called Very Games at the time. So if I'm like Titan, I'm like, I'm paying you to win those titles for me. I don't want everyone to go, course existence, one of the great players, you know, won many titles, like any of them under Titan, just one. Okay, cheers, mate. I'm paying you top money here.
Do we need to qualify this a little bit by talking about all the bullshit that went on in the French scene, the cheating scandals, the match fixing? You know, there's been some stuff that has fucking just gone through the French scene like a bushfire and pretty much altered irreparably the state of the French scene. It's been incredibly damaging. Is that enough of an excuse to say, yeah, well, Titan are going to suffer? Titan won't even be able to fix the problems once something like that occurs.
The biggest problem I see in the French scene is that there is no new talent. Mm. As in, there probably is, but there's nowhere that, like, I would never be able to find out who they are. I mean, everyone says stuff like, yeah, what about LDLC White when they had that one game? Yeah, exactly. They had one game at a French LAN. Like, what's the next LAN they went to after? Oh, none. You never heard from them again. Oh, okay. Well, that's what
didn't
I mean.
Didn't they play at the DreamHack qualifiers
for this
tour?
No, that's the tournament I'm talking about.
Oh, right. Yeah. I was gonna say,
they had one map that was like of any note, and so when are you gonna see them at their next LAN? I don't know, probably none, because I don't even know if they have the budget to go there. So if there is French talent, how do they get to these teams? How do these teams get them and give them a try? Hey, if I was Titan, maybe you do gamble on one of those guys. Even if it's not going to be that good, you're gambling that you're going to find someone who's very good. So that is a gamble, but maybe it might be worth it. I made a joke in the past, okay, that if I was I said something along the lines of, if I was like a skilled European player who isn't currently in a top six team, I would every day be paying some of that sick streaming money that I get, you know, for like an English tutor 2 hours a day to just teach me English. Because in 6 months, that might actually have been a better career investment than waiting for a top six team to pick you up. Like if I was Kenny S or Scream or something like that, you can't wait forever for that one team that's really good in France to recruit you if they're not going to do it. You might actually be better off, jokes aside, trying to get some other great European team to just take a chance on you if everyone can speak English, you know?
That's also kind of like saying you may as well go and teach yourself how to flip burgers as well, though. You know, that might be a better career investment than not getting picked up at all, you know? But I don't really know what the future holds for Titan. Like for me, there is a real air of uncertainty around that roster right now. I don't know if Maniac knows if he's all the way in or all the way out. I think existence is under tremendous pressure. People keep saying it's, you know, time for him to go and be a coach. And he has these moments of brilliance where you see the true intelligence of the player. And I've said it a million times, and I'll say it a million more. His transformation from being the flashy AWPer, a Guardian-style player, a Kenny S-style player, to being a tactical mastermind is one of the greatest transitions in any eSport I've ever seen. But I just think in the modern era of CSGO, you've got to put bodies down. You've got to put numbers up on the board. If you can't do that, you need to be stood behind people. And as we talked about at DreamHack, you know, NIP are already looking at experimenting with Natu doing all the calls. Maybe it's time, because we all know Niak, great a manager as he is, hugely successful manager. No one doubts his credentials in that area. But is he really a coach? What's he doing when he stood on stage? What's he saying to the players? If you put Kevin there and then add one more sick player to Titan, who knows what can happen from now. So I just think changes need to happen. I think changes are inevitable just on that basis. And if I was the players, if I was like existence, if I was NEAC, I'd be like, look, guys, we're going to have a very uncomfortable conversation with an organization that has invested so much into us. We need to head this off at the pass, and we need to decide what we're doing. And it starts with Maniac, shit or get off the pot. End. You know, that's the brutal reality.
I don't think that'll happen, though. Like, one of the problems in that team, this is part of why that whole envious ideological split exists, because it's almost like what it's basically, existence is the father, okay? When you're in his team, he decides everything. Like, he has the final say. He is the guy. Well, it's true. He knows more about the game than anyone. He probably knows more than you if you played the situation correctly. The problem with that is that's quite an overbearing relationship. Now, when you're under his thumb in that sense, okay, you have to buy into it. It's like, you know, I have no choice at that point. It's like being in the army. You have to do what your superior says. When you get out from that, then it's you immediately go as far from that as you can. Like, I'm not going to be any part of that. So the problem is, to me, I don't think any of the other players can get together and go, listen, we need you to retire. Like, I don't think that conversation will never happen as far as I can tell. So to me, if existence wants to play forever, then as long as the Titan, the organization, allows him to, he will control that team and he will play forever. Whether that means someone gets kicked out of the team, he'll be still there. So as far as I can tell, he'd have to choose to retire. So that's my problem, because here's the thing. When they were in Very Games, at the end of the Very Games era, when they didn't know where they'd go, he actually had said multiple times, like, maybe I'll just retire now. And this is when they were at top level. But then when he came back and they actually had all these problems and they were failing those majors, he actually repeatedly made these kind of weird interview statements where he said things along the line of, like, I won't retire until I've got back to the top again. Like now nothing can stop. It's almost like losing lit a fire under him, you know? And I think he almost wants to retire on his own terms. Like, he wants to get to number one again, then retire, you know? So I get the feeling, unfortunately, that that's the one thing he won't consider is retirement in that sense.
Yeah, no, I definitely get that. And I almost understand it in a way, you know? But equally, I think you can be part of, like, I don't know, would I rather be a player and a captain of a failing team, or would I rather be a coach of a successful team, a team that's winning? You know, I don't know, mate. It's probably a tough one for me to answer. I've done both in several sports, and I've got to be honest, when I was coaching, while it's a little bit like, you know, you think, yeah, I wish I was out there on the pitch or whatever, When your team wins, you get the same rush, I think. I did anyway. Maybe it's an individual thing. But yeah, anyway, I think watch this space when it comes to Titan. I think changes are looming. Winter is coming, I think, is probably the best way to summarize it. Just to wrap up the DreamHack talk, let's talk about the other two teams. I'll start with Dignitas, Team Dignitas, I should say, lest Odie gets upset because he doesn't want to be associated with the suicide clinic, I don't think. So, Team Dignitas. I'm still not really sold on them, but this event, you know, they did manage a win over Kingwin. They did manage to take some sizable number of rounds against NIP. I think it was 20 rounds across two maps, you know, pushed them kind of close on cash, definitely made a game of it. Is this team going to do anything anytime soon, or are we not really sold on it?
The problem with Dignitas, I think, is, like, I actually think even in terms of, it's just a performance issue for players, I think. I actually like the structure of the team. I think they have a decent pool of maps they're good on. They finally actually have some stability in terms of who's good. Like, Pimp and AZ are good pretty much every game. The problem is, amongst the others, some of them can be absolutely dire, as we saw. Like, Kirby can have four kills in a whole game. That can't happen if you're going to be a world-class team. So that's number one. And then number two, as harsh as this might sound to say, your best players are Pimp and AZ. Okay, well, which of the teams above them in the rankings can you play where their two stars are going to be beaten by Pimp and AZ? It's not going to happen that often, I'm afraid. So
yeah.
The problem with Dignitas is, I don't look at Dignitas and go, oh, they're underperforming. Like, I don't buy their shtick of, like, oh, we just did a few mistakes here and there. Again, they're another team to me where they actually are in a reasonable place. Like, I actually think they're reasonably consistent for who they are. I think that's what I expect from them, is about what we saw here. Maybe a slightly closer game against some teams, but I don't expect them to be bursting into the top four anytime soon. I'm just glad they're even in like an eighth or ninth best team, because obviously they were underperforming way more than that 3 months ago.
Do you think there's anything they could do to improve? I mean, for me, like I'm still not really sold. There was this big hype train about Kierby, which I've never really that train just left me at the station, I think. Not because he's not good, not because he doesn't have raw talent, but he does clearly go missing against big names. And I think we watched one game. Was it against Nip, I think, where he only got four frags?
Yeah, I think it was the Nip Mirage game.
Yeah, so that's horrible. That's like you need a real excuse to achieve four frags. I'm pretty sure me and you could probably have, you know, baited our way to four kills in a game. So I think he's got a bright future ahead of him, but so far it seems his development has stalled a little bit. Perhaps he's not in the right environment to reach his potential. But right there, I mean, you know, I look at guys like Asilian at SK Gaming, and I think if you take Asilian and you put him in Dignitas, they become a very different prospect.
You want a crazy name for me to say here?
Go on then.
So, okay, people who like this guy go way too far the other way. But as bizarre as it sounds, I actually might just put someone like Cadian in instead of Kirby. Now, I don't think Cadian's some super good
show's
player.
Show's over. Right, we're done.
I don't think he will ever be an elite level player, okay? But the thing with Cadian that I do like about him is the fact that he is an attention whore. And what I mean by that is this guy wants to be known as a good player, and he's actually confident in himself. Now, one thing I actually really do not like in players is players who are good, but they don't even themselves seem to know that they're good. It's like we can tell them they're good, but they're like, oh, I'm not sure. Like, I have problems on stage and stuff. That's the sort of thing where I'm like, sorry, mate, you got to get out. Like, I've got to, even if someone thinks they're better than they are, I'd rather they had some confidence in themselves, you know, because then I kind of know, like, it's like you're going to war, you know. You don't want to go to the war with the guy who's awesome sniper aim, but then like his hands are shaking all over the place with the gun. Like, I'd rather have a guy who's a grunt, but at least he's like, yeah, okay, I'll do my job, like go in there. So if you want to add a more stable piece, someone like Cadian isn't a ridiculous shout. Now, admittedly, apparently, well, I mean, this is apparently being proven. Apparently, literally 95% of the Danish scene like don't ever want to play with Cadian, so that might be an issue. No. I'm not saying it's perfect, Rich. I'm just saying if we're going to short-term fix...
Maybe. Well, look, yeah, not only that, though. I mean, come on, Duncan. You know he's kind of bad.
No, here's the thing. He's not actually that bad. His problem, Rich, is people don't like his personality. So as a result, and also he seems to think he's better than he is. So those two factors combined make people want to say he's worse than he is. He's actually
I get that, but I look at it objectively, all right? I mean, like, Cadian used to be one of those 1.6, we hate Cadred, we hate Source. If you have anything to do with that game, you deserve to die. You know, real fanaticist about it. And then, you know, he started sort of getting his shit together, maturing a bit. He clearly wanted to make a good go in CSGO. So you're right in that sense. He did want to be somebody. He wanted to be a player. But this guy, no. He's not cut out for a team game, in my opinion. And he's not even that good on an individual basis. And that's not to rip on the guy, because he's all right. But, you know, go stream or something. Like,
well, okay, then the players...
Like bring in War Owl.
Go to the flipping... go to the psychiatrist, mate. This is... At the end of the game, it's a game where you shoot people in the head virtually with AKs and then teabag them on the... So if you can't be like, oh, I'm a bit scared to shoot this AK, like, get out the game, mate. Get out the kitchen.
I agree. But, you know, don't forget, young guy, you know, this is Kirby, obviously, we're talking about now, okay. Not Kane so much. Young guy, you know, he's nervous.
Yeah.
You know, he's got big personalities in that team. A lot of hype on him because he's already had that good tournament, that breakout tournament. So it's like, you know... Tupac, okay. All eyes on me, you know, and he's not an OG, is he, mate?
What did Tupac do when he did that? He went straight in everyone's face. He started putting out diss records, telling them how he slept with their wife, said how he's going to kill everyone, started a war between it, civil war in his own minority group, Rich. Meanwhile, Kirby's just like, hope I have a good game, Gad. Pray, light a candle for me and pray that I have a good game. Like, I can't handle that, man. I mean, other people are welcome to do what they want, but, you know, I'd be like, listen, get the fuck out. You're actually sticking me. This is war right now. Basically, I'd put Kirby into a Full Metal Jacket style boot camp sequence. where either he was just broken completely or he came out a man. That's my suggestion to Dignitas. Full Metal Jacket boot camp sequence.
Let's do it. So Kier basically is Private Pyle.
Yeah, or he just blows Odie's head off with a gun.
Right, well, I think we'll leave the Dignitas section, you know, way back in the past. The other team, I'm sure we've got a wealth of material here as well. Kingwin, they were there. Lots of hype. Actually, on day one, peak numbers on the stream were when Kingwin played. And I kind of feel bad revealing that or acknowledging that. I don't want to encourage just picking up five fan favorites and pretending they're a team. But I'll ask your thoughts on this, Duncan. Did they do anything that made you feel, yeah, these guys are going to be ones to watch? Or do you still think of them as this almost like a social experiment or a fiscal experiment, I guess?
Nah, unfortunately. What they did was pretty much what I expected. Like, here's the thing. They could have done better. It's true. Like, hey, they could have a crazy map where in one map, somehow, maybe they have some godlike CT half, they win the game. But as we saw in that game there, yeah, okay, they could have decent CT side, but they had nothing on terrorist side, which is exactly the initial criticism you would bring up when you see five totally different nationalities, some of whom aren't even that good at English, speaking in a shared English language and trying to play after not having any history with each other or not even coming from the same cultural scenes. So put it this way, it would be a miracle if they became a top team. If they became a top team, that would be the team you make the movie about, you know, like you got all these five different players and somehow they figured it out and whatever happened, they found a style that worked, but it's very unlikely.
It's not very romantic, is it though? Because it's like, yeah, they figured it all out. These five players, you know, Mighty Ducks, but they're also being paid the most in Europe. Yeah, out of anyone. So.
The duck story at that point in time, is it?
Yeah, Mighty Cunts or something. I don't know. You're better with titles.
Your words don't mind, Rich. I just call them King Win. That's my name for him, yeah.
No, but I mean, again, this is like, for me, okay, being serious for a second, this is Shades of Titan, you know, a little bit. They brought in a bunch of fan favorites. I'm still not convinced by the team. I felt desperately sorry for Makalela. Clearly, he's had to basically step down from the AWPing role to accommodate Fox, and he's having to kind of play like a support player role where he just fills the gaps, and he's finding out what Fifth Lauren found out, which is when you're doing that, guess what? It gets hard to play your A game. That's bad for him because everyone sees him getting booted from NIP. There's rumors about his attitude. Will he get another chance in a top team if Kingwin fails? I'm not so sure. So for guys like him, this is a last chance saloon in a lot of ways. And it sucks if that doesn't work out because he's a great guy, great pro, and a talented player. But he'll be playing in Swedish mixes for the rest of his life when Kingwin get bored of this little fucking experiment. And I think that's a real possibility. And I got to be honest with you, I think that's a real possibility. You know, it's no secret the highest paid team in Europe. I mean, the money they're getting is ridiculous compared to some of the other teams. How long before Kingwin are like, okay, well, stream numbers for DreamHack are great and all, and it's great brand awareness, but actually we sponsor pretty much every other team in CSGO anyway. So if our flagship team, the team that bears our name, is failing, we're better off investing in something else. And they all get cut, and we all wonder, well, what was all that about?
I mean, do they even need to cut them all? I mean, if I was them, every other pro now knows Kingwin has all this money. What I can't understand, if we wait 3 months and they don't have more results, is why aren't players like Dennis, Twist, Pyth, why aren't these guys going to be the ones who just get drafted in, and let's remove one by one the parts that don't work? So I think there's light at the end of the tunnel. When you have that much money, and some of these players definitely could be good players, I think those are the two things that in theory should allow you to make a good team. You have the basis for a good team, and you have enough money to buy anyone to join the team. So eventually I think it should figure itself out. The problem is iteration one, I think, was a pipe dream. And I assume Kingwin themselves will realize that eventually.
Yeah, well, I agree with you. It still amazes me, though. Lots of... I know, like, okay, we've picked a lot of fan favorites, but if you pick fan favorites and then put them in a team and they don't win, don't we get into like a CLG type situation in League of Legends where it's like eventually the fans are going to turn and they're going to end up hating the players they once loved for their underachievement?
I mean, I think that would happen eventually. I actually think part of it's not even just the personality specifically of the players. I actually think in a weird way, it is that people naively think it's an underdog team, like we kind of mentioned. And they're not, because they're actually being paid way more than they should be. But just because of the story that everyone knows Scream has the skill to be in the top teams, but he can't be because people view him as kind of like a failed experiment. People know that McAlealy was tearing it up on Nip, but then got kicked out. So they kind of, I think they feel for these players and they're like, oh, I hope they could get revenge on Nip and get revenge on Titan and, you know, all that sort of thing. So the problem with that storyline is that that's going to run its course, you know. Either you do it, great, and you did it, or you don't, in which case everyone's like, well, I'm not going to hold out forever that eventually they once win a map. So I think that novelty can only last and carry them through this early phase.
Okay, so that's DreamHack in a nutshell. One last question about DreamHack, I suppose. Did you enjoy yourself, Duncan?
Yeah, it was all right. Excellent. I got to make fun of Anders, which you I know did. Everyone loves. Actually, you know, people send me letters like, oh, I love the part where you implied Anders was gay. Can you do that again? And I'm like, well, seems a bit gauche, really, but if you insist, you know, I'm only here to service my fan base.
You got to make fun of some of the sponsors as well, which I thought was a bold strategy, I thought.
Yeah, yeah. Hey, listen, it's much like Kingwin. It doesn't matter if Kingwin's losing as long as I say Kingwin 7 times in that sentence. So as long as I'm saying the name of the sponsors, pay me.
Right, let's move on to the news, okay. Of which there were some little bits and pieces. Obviously, DreamHack dominating the headlines. Penta Sports picked up their fifth player, Trubly, who had his retirement, which we talked about in the last show. They brought in Crisby. That's Christian Crisby Schmidt. How do we feel about this? Do we think this is the missing piece of the Penta jigsaw and they're going to be really good now? Or, like me, do you think this is something of nothing? This isn't really going to help. And Crystal is absolutely slumming it right now.
If I wasn't being paid to give you an opinion right now, I would just say, I don't even care. And let's wait until they do something on LAN. Because that is kind of how I feel about a lot of these German teams, to be fair. Like, I look at some of the players. Some of them are decent. But in general, like, here's the problem. There's no one player who's like some super duper star who goes above and beyond all the other Germans. And it's like, oh, he's like as good as an Olaf M, but he doesn't have the plain team that's around him. So that in itself kind of makes it a bad situation because the teams aren't that great. They're just all right. And then it's not like they have one or two stars who at least can draw you in. So at the moment, unfortunately, the German scene's a bit boring to me. And I'm waiting for them until someone can do something good on LAN. I can't get too invested. So all these moves look okay. Nothing looks great. Nothing looks terrible. But let's actually get a 5-man together that can do something more than the past ones did. Then we can start to worry about, where is Germany in the top 10? You know, where can they reach number 7 and stuff? Because at the moment, I don't think anyone cares about that except for people in the German scene. I mean, there's almost no hype. Think about this. All the hype about the NA scene for obvious reasons, but there's no hype about the German scene. I don't even see German guys talking about all the time. Like, oh, just wait until this guy plays a big LAN. I don't even see any hype from them.
I think it's quite sad, really, because, again, going back to the source here, and I know this was true a little bit in 1.6, although not quite so much, you know, back in the mouse sports days, obviously. But German EPS for source players was considered the promised land. They even went through a phase, if you remember, with MTW, you know, picking up foreign players to bring in to the team, and everybody knew, like, oh, the rules about, oh, how many foreigners can we have? Foreigners were going out there because it was one of the few actual leagues where you could join an organization, get a decent salary, and certainly decent by those standards in source. And you were playing in a structured league on an anti-cheat week in, week out, that was being broadcast, that was being streamed. That was like the dream for source players. That's why, you know, some of the best UK players played out in Germany. You know, Huds G, Will Zoo, you know, guys like this. Rattlesnake, of course, played for Mouse Sports, MX, you know, guys like this, right? So I don't know. But back then, German players as well, there was like so many teams, there was so many upsets. You had some true greats. And now it just seems like you couldn't even pick 5 players to make a team that could realistically have a deep, like an even shocking deep run into the tournament. So I have no idea why it's gone so backwards, given that they had all the infrastructure to be successful. Makes no sense to me.
This sounds like a ridiculous answer, because I'm now going to use that to say nothing about the German scene and just take a dig at NA and other games. But here's the problem. That's why I get so annoyed when people in, first of all, in other games, StarCraft, League of Legends, but even in CS. So in CSGO, NA teams saying stuff like, well, we don't have the same infrastructure and, you know, our teams don't get salaried and all this stuff. It's like, you know, you have to still have talent at playing the game as well, right? You know, you can't just put anyone in like an awesome AK racing chair and give them the best mouse and pay them a salary and have them have a first-class flight. That won't make them knock Olaf M's head off at the next LAN, you know. You actually have to have talent at the game. Like, all those excuses, yeah, it's true to a degree. But the problem is, in general, if you look at scenes that didn't have those resources but did have talented players, there's always at least some light at the end of the tunnel. Like, there's always the one great player, or there's always, like, the half a team where they've got one or two good players, one or two that aren't great, so great, but the style works. Like, hey, look at Keed Stars. You want to talk about infrastructure? Keed Stars is way better than any German team, and they have no infrastructure. They've had to literally beg and borrow to get any kind of money and now try and move to NA, basically. So I think if you actually had the talent, it would bear out eventually. It might take longer because you don't have infrastructure. Now, in terms of Germany, to bring it back, it's true. Even to this day, I get the feeling a lot of teams, like a Mousespots, etc., wish the team was better, and they probably would invest more if it was and make it a big focus. So it's almost the other way around. The players have to step up, and then I think the scene will follow them, because beyond what team you play for, you're actually ideally placed if you're in Germany. You're very central. Flights are going to be decent everywhere. There's events in Germany as well. That's a big bonus right there. Yeah. You get to not have to fly your team for like one or two events. So there's all these things going for them, and they don't have anything at the moment. So I think that more just speaks, unfortunately, kind of if you're referencing, where's all the talent gone? It's just, for some reason, whether it's just a bad crop at the moment, all the good players retired, I don't know. There just doesn't seem to be a whole lot of talent at the moment, or at least star-level talent.
Yeah. Other news, this just came in today. Vox Eminor, their team, the Australian, you know, the best team in Australia, the whole of Oceania. Yep. They're going to be without an organization. However, I'm reliably informed they will be in an organization very soon. What do we think about this then? I mean, this seems to me to be a precursor to them moving to a bigger organization that's going to give them support. If that is the case, what can this team realistically achieve?
Okay, so I don't want to, I'm going to officially break this, guys. The NIP organization, they've fallen on such hard times that when they saw Vox win one map against Fnatic, they were like, listen, I think it's time. The move's obvious here, guys, you know. These guys speak great English, great on camera. No, I think it's good for Vox, obviously, because I want to see them at more events. Like, I'm not sold that they're going to be some super duper team, but hey, let's give them a chance. Let's have them at three or four LANs within a 5 or 6 month span. And then let's see. Let's have it as being an experiment. Because here's the thing. They are the most exciting outsider team, because they are the one team that at the moment have a bit of kind of spunk to them, but also do have some legitimate reasons to say that they might be better. When some of these other teams say it, like I've mentioned already, some of these other scenes, I'm like, well, you do kind of have the infrastructure. Okay, this team can't play against the best teams at the moment, can't attend very many events. So let's take care of some of those by hopefully them joining a bigger org, and then we'll actually get to see, we'll have a reasonable conclusion on how good can they be.
I mean, it's going to be interesting to see how it pans out. I mean, of course, they've achieved great things, and this organization was never really an organization to begin with. It was a bunch of friends, a guy behind the scenes that was helping them get sponsors, helping them raise money, and they achieved all of this. You know, they were attending events like Gfinity, taking a map off Fnatic, taking a map off NIP. They were hugely disappointed, actually, to not go through the group, and it's interesting, if they took one map off Na'Vi, I think it was, they would have done. They got absolutely beasted by Na'Vi, and that was their downfall. So I think there's a lot of potential in the team. The question, of course, remains is that will this organization they're going to join, will it be able to support them in a way that enables these people, these players, guys like Sponge, guys like Havoc, to leave their job or to like work less hours? You know, Sponge is a plumber, you know, like Havoc's a laborer, I think. You know, these are down-to-earth, blue-collar guys that work full-time and have already achieved great things. Now, I don't even know if they want to walk away from that, but I think if an organization can pay them a real salary, I think they've got the drive and the hunger to break into that top 10.
I'm still not entirely sold. The biggest upside for me for Vox is actually the JKS guy, the guy who had this crazy tournament at Gfinity. Yeah, I want to basically, he's the main guy where I want to see like two or three more international lands to see whether that was like a one-off or whether he just had like his best possible spike there. And he'll turn out to be a good but not incredible player. If he really was as good as he was at Gfinity, if that happened, then they would have what I just described. Or even if you're a bad region, you have some one player or two players who can compete with the best. If that happens, yeah, you can now legitimately potentially be a top 10 team with all the other factors. So I'm still not sold on it entirely. I think there's still a lot of European teams could become better and overtake them. So I just want to see it happen, and apparently it will.
Okay, awesome. Last piece of news, and then we'll take a quick look at the ESL, ESEA Pro League. Won't have as much time to do our usual length roundup. But the last piece of news I will draw your attention to is, of course, the ESWC invites that have just gone through. Now, we were a bit critical, more than a bit, and perhaps rightly so, of ESWC. We were talking about how some of the qualifiers had been run and, you know, how the tournament had really lost some of its luster in modern times. We talked a bit about Bercy, which was, you know, one of the great esports events of all time, a real turning point, and how far ESWC has fallen from that ideal. But looking at this list of signups, now that they've added Kingwin, LGB, and CLG, it looks like it's a pretty good tournament. Just before we pontificate on that point, I do want to mention there was a lot of talk in the NA scene about whether Luminosity should have been invited ahead of CLG. So I will ask you your thoughts on that point. Okay.
I don't know what the bracket actually looked like in that qualifier, but I don't actually follow the logic. Like, okay, apparently Luminosity finished ahead of CLG in the bracket. Okay, that's great. But who did CLG play? Did CLG play Cloud9? Did they play Team Liquid? Like, you got to give me some info there. Like, who did they play at what point in the bracket? So I think, to me, CLG, Luminosity, it's kind of a toss-up. They're both a similar level at the moment. I don't really mind who gets invited there. It's kind of a storm in a teacup to me. It's not big enough on either side as to why you should invite that. What, so because the team online had some good games, they definitely have to be the LAN, and anyone who says otherwise is an idiot. Like, it's not really that big a deal to me, so I'm not really sure why people are so outraged on that. I have to say, I think you might have oversold the event a bit. Like, when you were saying those names there, yeah, now that they've added Kingwin, yeah, we just realized their shit. LGB, they were basically punching bags at the last tournament. It should be a good event. Like,
punching bags that took, it was 13 rounds off Fnatic.
Okay, congrats. That's because when you're playing against bots, Rich, like, unless it gets behind you and knifes you, like, you know you're going to kill it eventually. So,
hey, well, okay, well, let me play a bit of devil's advocate here. Okay. I mean, who would you add to this to put it over the top? So Fnatic are there, yeah. Nip are there, Na'Vi are there.
I'll tell you right now, Rich, so you can tell me the first four names, delete all the rest, and I can tell you tons of names I'd add. So how about TSM, Virtus Pro, Titan? Titan, three deep right there.
Yeah, well, Titan have still got a chance to go.
Okay.
Because they haven't done the ESWC French qualifier
Hellraisers.
Yet. Right? And the CIS qualifier hasn't been played yet either.
Okay.
But Keedstars are there, Liquid are there. Obviously not Vox Eminor anymore are there. Cloud9 are there. We've got a Chinese team there.
As of right this second, this tournament has four teams that are in my top 10. That's all right.
Yeah, but it's not just about the top 10, is it? Don't you
think? Depends what you want to see. Is this an exhibition tournament? Is this the Harlem Globetrotters?
No, but what I mean is, okay, like, right, so Keedstars, okay, you see, you've created a bit of a catch-22 here, a bit of a logical fallacy, because your top 10 operates on the premise that if you go to events and you place well, you increase your ranking. Now, if you don't go to events and you're not playing against top teams, how can you do that? So this is the opportunity. Like, I'm intrigued to see how is a Keedstars going to measure up against the likes of a Fnatic or an Envious, should they play them. I think Cloud9, you know, okay, they're a bit of a known quantity. Fair enough. CLG, we haven't seen really how they measure up against Europeans for a while. I think the Vox Seminole have their new organization by then. They're going to be, you know, they train specifically to beat Europeans and have proven they can take maps off them. You know, a Chinese team. And we've still got the possibility and probably will have Hellraisers and Titan there on top as well.
It's an all right event. I'm not that psyched about it myself.
I'm not, look, I mean, I don't want to oversell it. I'm not saying I'm massively psyched. I'm not looking at it like, yeah, this is like Worlds, motherfucker. This, but, you know, I think what I'm excited about is that it's we're going to see teams potentially play teams that in matchups we might not get to see for like another year, you know?
Okay, well, I'll be honest with you right now, Rich. That doesn't excite me much. Like, if they do something, then come.
All right, Shania Twain. Yeah. What the fuck is this?
Right now, I don't give a flying fuck about half of the teams on this list. Like when you were going through that list there, one team's from China. They eat with chopsticks. Should be amazing. Like, all right, man, I don't give a fuck. Like, let me know when they're any good at the game.
Yeah, but how are we going to find out? They've got to play.
I'll tell you how we find out, motherfucker. Thunderdome, two men enter, one man leaves. This event should be all shit teams. It should be like a fighting pit, and the four that leave are allowed to go to a real tournament.
Well, look, man, I'm relatively excited because what I've wanted for the longest time is, like, I keep talking about it, conquering that Asian market, right? I want to see Chinese players get into CSGO. So when we do have an IEM, you know, we can actually have one in that area. I want to see Korean players get into CSGO. I want the game to go free to play. Fuck it. I don't even care if it only goes free to play in the Asian market and all the European and NA bitches are fucking crying about it on Reddit. I wouldn't give a fuck.
Listen, right? Rich, I have no doubt. I've mentioned this on past shows. China and Korea, Asian countries, they did at times have really good teams. I've even made the case in the past. I think Koreans and Asians in general, like their dedication to games is so crazy. They could learn almost anything. I mean, Rich, I've seen videos where they could spit ping pong balls at. So I've no doubt they could be good at CSGO. But until they are, I don't want to see someone fail to spit a ping pong ball at. Hello.
So, ESWC. Yeah, it's going to be good, man. right. So, yeah, I think we'll move on. We'll move on. Should we talk about the ESL, ESEA Pro League?
Yeah, let's do it. It's no Chinese team.
Let's do it. There's no Chinese. We're safe there, mate. So, recent results that have happened since the show last aired. Let me just double check the dates. So we've had, you know, it's some leveling, I would say, in the NA scene. Luminosity Gaming beat CLG. This is another reason why people are sort of not outraged, but are kind of saying, you know, they should be there. Keed Stars had a absolute epic game, 31-27 against Luminosity. And again, that even though Luminosity lose that, that's another reason why everyone are like, yeah, man, Luminosity are the real deal. And, you know, I got to agree. I think this is a team that's getting better and better and better every time they play. And they've got real upset potential. I do think, to criticize ESWC a little bit, they definitely missed a trick not picking them up. You know, in inviting them. They're now third place in the league. We'll come to those standings in a minute. And then on top of that, we've had in Europe, TSM back to winning ways. Hellraisers less so. Virtus Pro and TSM picked up wins against them. Envious, no surprises, beating Penta. At least they turned up for that game and were able to play that one out. Virtus Pro had a narrow game against Mouse Sports, but then continued a run of good form. They had a double header against them. They had a 16-14, the 16-8. And then this is the big one for me. This was on Tuesday. I know, obviously, TSM had already qualified, and it didn't really matter or whatever, but Envious beat TSM 16-13 on Dust2. First of all, I'll just ask you a question about that game. You know, a lot of people are saying, you know, envious, only won because TSM weren't trying, because they've already qualified. Like, is that even a plausible argument? I don't buy it.
Not entirely, because even if you had qualified, so there's like some psychological basis where you're not like, it's not like the game of your life and death, you know? Even so, most teams when they play, they're going to at least give like 80% performance anyway. So it's not like if TSM had been playing with the same mentality and they'd played Penta, that Penta would have just beaten them as well. No, TSM would have won the game. So I don't think that entirely works. It does help that Envious is still scrapping to ensure they get there. So there might be a little bit more boost on Envious. But also, let's not forget, Envious haven't done anything big in a while, but they're still, in theory, one of the best teams in the world. They're still right up there, like at least on the very lip of being an elite level team. And that was Dust 2, one of their classic maps. So yeah. I think the pieces are there, why it makes sense as to why Envious could win that game.
And I think let's talk about the European standings overall. Some talking points here. We'll start at the bottom. No surprise to see Flipside down there for all the issues we've talked about. The simple ban, the stand-in, Bondic just being swollen up like something out of The Witcher. So, you know, they've had a bad run. Penta, same, just, you know, without the disease. Mouse Sports, they're really struggling, although they did get the best deal of the German shuffle, which we've already established is, you know, just fairly poor anyway. Titan, fourth from bottom, with only 7 wins and 18 played. That for me, again, that all adds extra pressure, extra weight to the theory that they're going to change. And then this is where it gets interesting, middle of the pack. So Dignitas, okay, you expect them to be down there. Na'Vi, only 9 wins from 19. They had a poor run lately for 27 points. They're out of the running at this juncture. NIP are there, like in sixth spot with 19 played, 12 wins, 36 points, just behind Hellraisers.
Yeah, their problem is that Fnatic has all those games in hand. So
yeah.
For NIP to actually make it in, I mean, basically I think they have to win all the remaining games and hope that other people lose all their games. So it's not that likely, to be fair.
So, oh, and obviously, yeah, sorry, a game has just been played. They have gone ahead of Hellraisers. Sorry,
my okay. Bad. So the problem there, like I say, is that it's like almost everything has to go right for NIP. I mean, when I look at the teams there, the only one that's a surprise is Envious because they've been having problems recently. The rest, it all makes sense. Like TSM, Fnatic, VP, for me, those are the three that definitely should be at the land. So I expect that they'll all make it, especially because Fnatic has so many games in hand.
Yeah, and let's draw some attention to this crazy run. I mean, two crazy runs, but we haven't talked about Virtus Pro yet, so we will. Virtus Pro having a great run in ESL, ESEA. A lot of people are like, hey, they're terrible online. People didn't factor them in to the top four here. I think people even were putting some pundits or whatever. You know, you think about it, Titan aren't there, Na'Vi aren't there. You know, I think NIP aren't likely to be there. So I think some people were like, Virtus Pro finishing above them is kind of a little bit surprising, especially given that it's online. Now, they've got games in hand against Envious and can finish further up. They've got 15 wins in 19. It's a ridiculous record. So, I mean, how are they doing this?
I mean, for me, VP, on paper, they should be one of the stablest teams. They keep the same roster. They keep the same playing style. They always come back into these runs of form. Even a bad month or two is followed by a good month or two. Actually, I think a league format suits them. Like, sooner or later, it's going to come around again. They're going to be a good team. That's also why I thought if Envious just stuck with it, like I said on past shows, they'll get there eventually, you know. The teams where it's more worrying for, the ones that are kind of just stuck in the place that they are now at the moment anyway, like NIP and Titan, etc. Those are the ones where I understand why they're not doing so well. For VP, I think they always should be a top team. At the moment, I can't see any reason why they should drop out of the top 4 or 5 realm, you know.
And the Envious run as well. I know obviously you've got a soft spot for Envious. There was a point where they were right down the bottom of the table. We were talking about them, you know, oh, maybe they're going to miss out. Would that be unthinkable? What sort of pressure is that going to apply on them? And the run they've had has been insane. And the results have been really good. They've had some close games where they've narrowly lost. You know, I think they took 14 rounds against Fnatic, I think. You know, but ultimately, the run they've had to get right up there has been very impressive.
Yeah, I think overall, this is why I want to see them at Atlanta again soon, because I actually wonder if Atlanta it's going to carry over and they'll be back to near best form. I don't think it's entirely implausible, but we'll have to see if that actually translates offline.
Okay. And we'll just take a look at the NA scene before we wrap up and some of the results that have been going on with NA teams. Now, I already told you about the results that CLG and Luminosity have had. Luminosity going on a great run to get to third place in the league, just behind Keed Stars. Nihilum clinging on there. They're still in the top four, although they're now level on points with CLG and Elevate, but have got more games to play. So this is where it gets interesting. Moving into the NA playoffs, it's still all up for grabs. We had a run of games where Cloud9 have asserted their superiority in the region. No real surprises there. The last two games they played were 16-4 against Team Liquid and on Dust2 and a 16-4 against Mousepaz on Cobblestone. Cloud9 aren't even really being tested at the moment. They've got 16 wins from 19. They're way out in front. And just behind them is, of course, Keed Stars, who've been keeping up with it. And this is despite all the problems we've had with DDoSing and having to forfeit games and that kind of thing. Still second. So just some thoughts about, first of all, I mean, we haven't changed our minds about Cloud9 being the superior team in the NA scene, have we?
I mean, there's no reason to change your mind, really. So yeah. I think that's the non-story there, that they're just the best still.
Yeah, I thought so. Luminosity, though, how much have they impressed you in their sort of ascent to that top four? You know, this is a team, obviously, that I think a lot of people, they were like, ooh, it's a bit of an unknown quantity. But they've actually been performing incredibly well in this league. And right now, it's got to be said. You know, I mean, there's an argument there that they could even pip Keed Stars. It's still possible for them that they could finish second. I don't know if you've had a lot of time with all the events and all the traveling to watch the team, but what have you made of them if you have?
I've seen a couple of games, and the thing is, I actually think of the teams who are in the top 4 to 5 in NA, the two that have the most potential is Luminosity and Nihilum. Like, those are the two where I'm not sure. I feel like one of those two is going to become like the clear second best team. Because at the moment, Cloud9, they're the best because everything's just come together immediately when they got the new lineup. So they kind of got lucky right off the bat. Okay, they're the best team by default. Keed Stars at the moment is understandably in second place because they're a really consistent team. They have good parts. They play the game the right way. But I think whichever team gets it together out of Luminosity and Nihilum is going to be the second best team in this region. And I'm not sure which one it will be at the moment because Luminosity seem like they have the players, but I actually think Nihilum as a like the team concept, I think they have a better unit, if you know what I mean.
Mm. I mean, I think that the way they've drafted players in, you know, I didn't know what Pyth was really going to do. You know, I thought with the whole sort of Orbit thing, it was just basically another gap year experience, you know, go out, play in an NA team, have fun, party. Maybe you don't achieve too much. And then obviously you add PTR, you know, you add Peter to the mix who came from CLG. I really like this. They got the experience in the form of anger. They got raw talent. They've got a European, which obviously is always going to help you in NA. That Europeans are the Koreans in a lot of ways in NA CSGO, if history shows us anything. So I think this is a team I really like the look of. And I'm certainly hoping that they can make good on some of their performances. And I want to see them at more tournaments. I want to see them. I don't know if they've not got the backing or whatever, but I want to see them get to some events.
Yeah, that's what sucks at the moment is that in Europe we have all these LANs, but we just never get to see the NA teams there. So we've seen Liquid and Cloud9 a bit, but these other teams, I mean, when are we going to see Nihilum at a LAN? When are we going to see Luminosity? I still don't know. It might just be ESEA. That might be it.
Yeah. Okay, and then just a final talking point. It is that battle for fourth spot. It's currently a bit of a three-way tie. Nihilum, which, of course, is the Hiko and Semfish show. They're on 33 points, 16 games played. CLG, 17 games played, 33 points. And Elevate, who are probably out of the running because they've got 33 points as well and have played 20 games. So CLG and Nihilum would need to go on ridiculously poor runs for Elevate to sort of sneak in at the end and pip it. I'm guessing you feel Nihilum are going to finish above CLG. And if so, do you think that's fair based on their rosters?
Yeah, I think at the moment the standings as they are right now is who the top four will be for this LAN finals. CLG, obviously, there's not that many games left. They could have the odd game that gives them a chance. But, I mean, here's a weird way to look at it, okay? Look at the top five teams in NA and then look at the round difference that they all have, okay? So Cloud9 has like 80+. Keedstars has almost 60. Luminosity has 60. CLG has 70-something. Nihilum has 20. Now, what a massive drop-off that is. I've said this on this past show. What's weird about Nihilum is the way they've impressed me is that their number of close wins they've had. And to me, close wins, I'm not the guy who's like, wow, how lucky. It's like you can't be lucky that many times. To me, close wins means there's games where things went wrong. You had to execute at the end, or you were out getting outplayed by one player, but you still found a way to win that. I actually think close wins is a positive because most people always tend to go the other way and they go, oh, well, I was so close to beating you. And it's like, yeah, those guys, there's a million losers in million bars with stories like that, you know. I actually think it's a positive that this team manages to do that. Whereas you look at, okay, CLG, okay, they have the second highest round difference in the league, but they're in fifth place. Why is that? I mean, they're obviously, they stomp you or they lose, you know, the narrow close game. They can't close the close game. So to me, I actually think in a weird way, that's kind of how I see the two teams. I think Nihilum's just a step above as a team, but I think CLG can be explosive. But I would put my money on Nihilum. I think it's a safer bet to get that fourth spot.
So, you know, there's still spots up for grabs. It's going to be interesting to see what happens. Just looking at the run-in in the NA one, you know, you can see, obviously, Cloud9 are on cruise control. Nihilum do have to play Counter Logic Gaming on Friday, which, you know, that's obviously a real six-pointer, and it's compounded by the fact that on Sunday, they got to play Luminosity. And interestingly enough, Luminosity follow that game up by playing Cloud9 the same day. So there could be a lot of movement at the top of the NA scene. If Luminosity can make good on their promise, which I'm sure Counter Logic will be having their fingers crossed on Monday, they got to play Keedstars after all. There's some big, big games happening in that top four, top five. So it's going to be interesting to see how it all pans out. And of course, you should totally, which we haven't had a lot of time to plug, you should totally draft some teams on Alpha Draft. Yeah, there we go.
Do it if you want.
We haven't had time to look at the stats today. Sorry if that's the kind of juice that you're into. But next show, we'll definitely get them in there. Lots to talk about coming out of DreamHack. But I think at this juncture, we will end the show. All that remains to be said, of course, is thanks to you, Duncan. I guess you're going to go watch some videos of ping pong now.
Yeah, reminisce on the good old days.
Yeah, well I might. I was going to say I might join you. That's creepy as fuck. I mean, separately. In separate houses. Like, you're not just in...
I'll be there in spirit.
Yeah, good. Like my dead grandmother or something. But anyway, thanks a lot for your contributions to the show. Although I might not be saying that after the meetings that I always have. Yeah, you did a terrible job as a host to control and Duncan. He's just out of control. Ping pong shows, what the fuck? But you know, maybe we're back next week. Who knows? Thanks to Sam for producing the show. Thanks to all the people who tuned in. And if you're watching the VOD, thank you very much for doing so. But until next week, when we will be back at the same time, take care of yourselves and may all your drafts be alpha.